ACA presents. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to judge you, but if you don't stay for this ACA presents, I'm going to judge you. Okay, because I want to tell you something. When I sent David an email asking, more like begging, for him to come here, I never in a million years thought I would get a response back. Let alone did I think I would get a response back that said, absolutely, I would love to come and do this. And he flew here from Germany. Yeah, wow.
He lost his luggage.
And he lost his luggage, to which Dwayne found a day. No, I was there at midnight last night trying to find that luggage. I am the saver. What?
Trying.
Oh, shut up. All right, you loser. So, Dwayne now has his luggage. David can be fully clothed, have his comfortable being. Yeah, so that's great. So, okay. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, please take your seats. Please take your seats right now. Thanks, Roy. Thank you. If you're in the back, bring your butt to the front. Not you, Danny. Please stay in the back. You're an idiot.
Your butt can come up because you have to stay back.
That's right. Okay. All right, come on in, grab a seat. Less talking, more walking. Put this over here and out of your way. Okay. Everybody, let's grab a seat. All right. So, you kind of got a feel for ACA Presents last night with Steve. I'm shocked he got as much out as he did. But it is my honor tonight to present you the one and only, the clown's clown, David Shiner.
Okay.
Yeah, and these clothes are sticking to me after 5 days of wearing them.
Okay, one of the things we try to do is find out how people got to this, almost to the starting point, that things shot up. Because we can, you know, that's all there. And a lot of it's biographical.
You eat the microphone, I've been told. Thank you.
So, where were you born? What, tell them about your family.
I was born in Boston, Massachusetts. I'm one of eight children.
Which top, right, bottom, or middle?
I was right in the middle. I have a twin sister as well.
Okay.
Yes, and four boys, four girls. Yeah, it was a strange childhood. I remember a lot of it. I don't remember, but I do remember this night in Boston. I was woken up at, I guess, 2 a.m. And my mother said, get up, we're moving to Colorado. The house is almost empty. My father was a truck driver then. And he had packed all of the furniture in the back of this semi-truck, including the Plymouth. And at that time, I guess we were six kids, yeah. And you know, those trucks, they only have, in those days, it was just, you could only sit three up front. And so we kids were in the back of the semi truck, sitting in the Plymouth. Mm-hmm. And he got papers, fake papers, and he was carrying tomatoes, delivering, you know, hauling tomatoes. Okay. So he was hauling his family. Uh-huh. And I remember it was a long trip, and every time we got to a really big steep hills, we all had to get up in the front of the cab, all of us. And I just remember sitting on the transmission burning my ass as he would just up these mountains. And that's how my father was. So we got to Colorado and he parked the truck facing the mountains. He opened the door and said, "Well, here it is, kids, your new home." I was just looking out at this vast prairie, because in those days in the 60s, it was the suburbs of Denver, it was just all farmland. And you could basically hike all the way to the foothills. And now it's just suburbia all the way to the foothills. But that was an interesting childhood. So I grew up part of my time, part of my childhood was in Colorado. And then he hauled
How
us.
How old were you when this moved out?
I was 10. Okay. It was 1963. I was 10 years old, yeah. And, I don't want to go into detail to see the boy to death, but...
I'm already relating very well, I'm sure some of them here.
The beauty of growing up with so many brothers and sisters was we were always playing. You were never alone at home, and there was always something going on. But I hated school. I hated it with a passion. Public schools in Colorado in those days were just, it was just so primitive. And I just hated it. I was always ditching school, always getting in fights. And I did really poorly. I thought I was stupid. I hated it, just absolutely hated it. And I think, you know, as a sensitive kid, I was really picked up on the energy of the teachers. And, you know, they just weren't really very nice. I mean, you either cut the mustard or you didn't. Either you were passing or you weren't. And the only way I got by was making everybody laugh. I was a class idiot. And was sure the teacher's crazy. But it wasn't because I was stupid. It was just... you know, when you're a real sensitive kid, and I had troubles anyways. I remember once, I must have been 12 or 13, and I woke up from an afternoon nap and reality had changed. I got sick. And in those days, there weren't many, you know, child psychologists around, so my parents just took me to a regular practitioner. And he said, "Oh yeah, he's just stupid, you know." But this illness was, you know, when you're 10 years old and you get sick like that, it's terrifying. You know, especially when you know that nobody can help you, your parents can't help you. And going to those schools definitely didn't help. Mm-hmm. And but you know, you grow and you grow up, you do your best as a kid to get through whatever it is you have to get through. But luckily, I had lots of brothers and sisters, and children are very resilient in terms of having the capacity to put things away, you know, to find a way to get through, because you don't know what's going on. You just find a way to just put it out of your head, and so... what am I saying? I mean,
I think you're trying to say
it's you know, my childhood wasn't the happiest, but I had a wonderful mother and father. I mean, my father was, his whole thing was, I mean, he was a truck driver,
right?
And then he moved to Colorado because he didn't want to do that anymore. He took us out to Colorado. He got back in the truck, make sure everybody was okay. He bought a house on in a catalog for $13,000. He got a catalog, and, "Oh, we're gonna move there." And once he set us up in the house, he got back in his truck, was hauling, but he drove back with his rig and earned some money and hitchhiked back to Colorado, literally hitchhiked, and took night classes in computer programming. And during the day, he worked as a janitor. And he was super smart with mathematics. And, you know, he was a hood when he was a kid. My grandfather was, he was just a horrible man. You know, I think one day he got machine gunned off the road. He had a numbers racket, and my father spent 4 years in the war, and when he got out, he was just a hood. You know, there were a lot of gangs in Dorchester, in Boston. He was a member of a gang, always getting in fights and stuff. So whenever I had problems at school with somebody, my father would always say, he talked like this. I said, Dad, this kid, every day I go into art class, he's calling me a dehydrated prick, and these kids are always saying horrible things to me. And he said, all right, son, this is what you do. Tomorrow you go in. The next time he says that, you punch him in the face. You punch him in the face. He'll never tease you again. And so that's what I did. I stood up and went, bam! And the kid was big. And he just got shot. And of course, I got thrown out of class, got thrown out of school. But he never bothered me again. But that was my father's, you know, that was those days. Of course, you grow out of that. Yeah. Anyways, my childhood was very colorful and very painful. But you know, if I had to do it all over again, I'd do it again. I'd go through it again because I developed this very deep sensitivity and understanding of psychology and emotional, what it means to be an emotional person, to really be in touch with your emotions, to really understand what it means to go through something and survive it. Go through something that you think you can never survive, and you do, you know, you do. And I think the kind of childhood that I had and the way I was raised really marked me in a way that, you know, turned me into a really good artist. Because you take that pain, you take all of that experience, and you turn it into art, you transform it into art. And you don't know you're doing it until later. You go, oh, that's why. I mean, I was telling somebody today that when I started working on the streets in Paris in the early 80s, I was on the streets, and it was rough and tough. I mean, I was working at Beaubourg, and I first started on the streets in Boulder, Colorado, and I was working as a carpenter for about 10 years. And I was in Boulder for 5 years. And one day it was in the summer, I saw this clown on the street. No, he was a mime. In those days, it was Marcel Marceau, and all these white-faced mimes were doing the wall, walking against the wind, and doing the leans. There was a teacher there, a French guy. No, he was Jewish. Samuel Avital, who had a mime school. So I saw this guy and I looked in his hat and he had money and I thought, man, I can do that. Because I always wanted to. The first time I did clowning, I was 10. In fourth grade, we had the PTA meeting and the kids could do a show. And so me and Todd put together a clown show. And this was the number. He came to the doctor. I was the doctor, and he had a swollen stomach. Of course, it was a balloon filled with flour. And I did an operation on him, and the balloon burst, and all the flour came out. That was my first clown act. And I was 10 years old. Where the heck was I? So I thought, well, I put on a costume the next weekend. Made some costume. Made myself look like Marcel Marceau with a striped shirt and a hat with a feather, and I had this easel with the titles of my numbers, like the old man and the flower. It was so stupid. It was so stupid. It looked something like this. It was something like this. It's pretty bad. Oh. That was it. Then I can't remember how I ended it, but I had another one, the bird in the cage. It was a little bird who was trapped in a cage.
Oh my God.
And I can't do the whistle anymore. little bird that wanted to get out of the cage, and he'd go around the cage, you know, go around the cage, and do this, stupid. really bad mind. And so one day, and people would literally walk by and go, this is the worst mind I've ever seen. Literally. And I looked ridiculous. I had these yellow pants, and I looked so fairy. I looked like a fairy clown. I'm an artist. And of course, you know, you learn all the techniques, like, you know, walking into a bar, leaning in the bar, and drinking. But I love learning the techniques. It's a great way. It's a really great solid base for clowning, in terms of the point fix and all of that. But so nobody was watching me. And on Friday and Saturday night, they had just built this mall, a walking mall, not a mall, but yeah, that's what we call it. But they built this beautiful mall through the center of the town, and there was no cars. So these cars would pass by every each block. There was a road. And it was a beautiful place to work. And it was a Friday evening, and I thought, man, I'm getting nobody watching me. So a police car was coming through, and I just went out in the middle of the road, stopped the police car, he stopped. I opened the door and went, get the car. He got out, he played along, and I put him up against the car, and I frisked him. Into my pockets. That was really a rude thing. Get out of the way. And I got in his car and started to drive away, and that's when, oh, I said, that's when I just stopped. And so when I got out of the car, there was like 100 people there. And there were just 100 people. And I, this guy's crazy. And that's when I thought, ah, I'll start working with people. Ooh, yeah, I'll start working with people. So I start improvising with people. And it, you know, I was getting crowds and they were watching. And I was pretty brash and I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but people were watching. And one night, there was this juggling duo called Dr. Hot and Neon. They were really good. And I talked to them after the show, and I said, well where'd you guys, what's going on? Where'd you guys come from? Where are you from? Oh, we were just in Paris, man. You gotta go to Paris. You can work anywhere on the street. You gotta go to Paris. I said, really? Yeah, it's really cool. Paris, okay. So, what do I do? I stopped working as a carpenter, I packed my bags, I had one suitcase with my props and costume, and my other suitcase, some clothes. I can't remember, it was like nothing. And I had enough money saved to fly to Washington where my parents were living. And so I spent a couple nights there, and my father said, wait, what are you doing? I thought you were working in your Boulder. I said, well, Dad, I'm going to Paris. You're going to Paris? What are you going to Paris for? I'm gonna work as a mime on the streets. What? A mime? What the hell's a mime? So it's kind of a clown. You're going on the streets? I said, he was really terrified. Well, you need any money? I said, no, Dad, I've got some money. So I flew to Paris, right? I had no idea what the hell I was doing. I thought, yeah, Paris, cool, the streets, wow. I get there and I found this little dumpy hotel. And I don't know if you've been to Paris, but the hotel rooms are like this big. I mean, they're really tiny. It was just a dumpy place, and I thought, my first night, I thought, what am I doing here? What have I done? How do you have any money? And I was terrified. I suddenly realized that I didn't know what I was doing. But anyways, the next day I went and scouted where these jugglers told me you could work the streets. And one of the places was Beaubourg, Georges Pompidou. And there is a huge entrance into this museum. And that's where a lot of the street arts were working. But it was like a little mafia. If you came in and nobody knew who you were an outsider, and it was tough. You know, like, you know, what's this guy doing here? And so it was very difficult to, like, go in there it was kind of scary. The guy who was in charge of that whole area was a guy doing a robot, and he was in front of this huge pipe. They had these huge pipes at the entrance, and he would do the robot there, you know, all day long, the robot. You know, he was like the guard and the guardian of the place. Anyways, I started, you know, doing my stuff there, and I became more and more crazy. You know, the more I was working with people, the more outlandish I became, the more risks I was taking, and it was, you know, I was really aggressive, and I was a mean, nasty clown. I was a guy who had no patience, was just. And I got really good at standing next to, it wasn't always me, but I would do crazy things, like if a woman was there with her kid, I'd take the kid, you know, in the cart, and take it to somebody else and sell the kid to the guy. And what I loved to do when kids were there, I was a really sweet little clown, and I'd bring the kid out, and I'd find ways to improvise with the kid, which would, they do things spontaneously like kids do, and it would always get huge laughs. And then at the end, when I was done with the kid, I'd say, okay, I need some money. Give me some money. The kids were always like, what? I want some money, kid. And what I would do, I'd take the kid, I'd turn him upside down and shake him. I wanted money. And people would be screaming. I'd only do it if I knew the kid was game and, you know, I wasn't going to scare him. Because that was a part of the deal that you have to learn when you're working with people is understanding how far you can go and really sensing where they are emotionally. And, I mean, I learned a lot about body language. And so when you really know about body language, you know how far you can go with someone. And sometimes I go really, really far. But I knew that I could. Anyways, I'd shake these kids upside down, and sometimes it was so funny, like little cars would fall out of their pockets, and, you know, marbles, and chewing gum, stuff like that. But, you know, I'd go up to, like, these motorcycles, like, there were some really hardcore guys hanging around there, a lot of drug addicts, and a lot of guys out of work. But sometimes these motorcycle guys would show up in the leather and all of that, and I'd ask them for a kiss, and they were like, you know, they were having fun, and they give me a kiss on the cheek. I take my hat off and hit him over the head for kissing me on the cheek. And it was always, man, what's this guy just doing? Or I'd stand in front of them. I'd stand in front of these guys, like a big crowd. I'd stand in front of them. Hey, whoa, what are you doing? Hey. I'd push them back, you know, and I'd get into this whole thing about, you know, and box him. Just always, you know, just provoking in order to start an improvisation, whatever it was. So anyways, I worked on the streets for 3 years, and that's where I developed my style of work. And, you know, it's amazing. I was earning quite a bit of money, but I had only been there for, I think, like 2 months already, living in this dumpy little hotel. But one day I was talking to a guy who was talking to me after the show, and I said, man, I'm looking for an apartment, and I need some place to live. He said, oh, I'm going to India for 2 years. You can have my place. I said, really? Yeah, you can rent my place. So it was a little bit outside Paris, but it was 6 floors up. There was no elevator. And I'd be working the streets all day, and I had my suitcase was full of change. It weighed like 50 pounds. And I'd have to take the train. It was about a 15-minute ride from the station to this banlieue, this town outside Paris. And sometimes I was so tired after the show, I wouldn't even take my costume or makeup off. I'd just go into the metro with my suitcase, and I'd have to climb these 6 flights of stairs after, you know, 7 or 8 shows. But, yeah, that's where I really formed my style of work, was because you're doing it 6 or 7, you're doing it all day long. And so you start to develop, and also there was this huge window. I mean, it must have been, I don't know, 8 feet high, 10 feet high, and there were black curtains behind it. part of the museum. So when I wasn't doing the show, I'd be practicing my movements and, you know, practicing different technique, you know. So unbeknownst to me, I was developing this really strong style. And one day I was approached by a guy, Dominique Moclair, who every year he was doing Cirque du Demain, the Circus of Tomorrow, and for young artists. And they'd go in, and it was like a competition. And it's become quite famous now, but it would last, I guess it was about 4 or 5 days, and a lot of different artists, and there was a jury. And so I participated in that thing, and they wanted to throw me out. Because I know who was in the jury that year was the guy from he ran the Big Apple Circus. What's his name?
Paul Binder.
Paul Binder was in the jury. I didn't know Paul, but he told me what was going on after I did my performance. Like all the French, you know, the French directors were incensed. Oh, elle peut pas faire ça. He can't do that. He's aggressive. You know, he goes into the audience. He's stealing people's wallets. He's passing out their money. He's the guy's crazy. This is not circus clowning. I had a really bad. They hated me. And then somebody else told me who was eventually became part of Cirque du Soleil. He was also in the jury, and he told me this story that. That night, the second night I was there, everybody was still really upset. And this Russian clown, Nikolai Yuri, very famous Russian clown, apparently he said to all of them, "You're all crazy. This is the clown of the future. This is the clown of the future." I don't know about that, but that's what he said. He recognized something. I had talent, but I had no idea what the hell I was doing. I was just all over the place. So I didn't win anything there, absolutely nothing. But then I ended up working in a very small circus, Le Puits aux Images, the Images of the Well. And I was with them for about, I don't know, 3 months. It was a tiny little circus that just basically played for school kids and stuff, toured around the ball in Europe outside of Paris. And we set up the tents and all of that. That was before I did the festival, Cirque du Demain, but Bernard Powell, who ran the Circus Roncalli, saw me there, and he hired me for his circus in Germany, and so that was my first professional gig, and I did 1 year there, and that was enough for me. I mean, I became like this big star overnight. At that time, Circus Roncalli was like the most successful circus in the world. It was beautiful. I mean, it still exists, but it's not anything like it was. I guess about 1,200 seats, all cotton tent, old circus wagons, all really restored beautifully. It was a real jewel, a diamond. It was full every show. And I brought the house down every single show. I hated the afternoon shows because, you know, there was a lot of screaming kids. And
so they plucked you out.
Okay. So they plucked you out. And just accepted the persona and the show that you had already developed.
I hadn't developed anything.
Well, you did something.
Well, I mean,
they saw you.
That's where I first did the car number.
Okay.
I'd never done that before. And I just thought, what am I going
to
do for this?
Did they try to mold you in another way at any point, or just
say, this
is exactly what we wanted, well, we want you exactly what you were doing?
Well, the thing about Bernard Paul, he saw the potential in me, I had to learn really fast. To develop the street stuff, which is really raw and in your face, and you have to really work hard to keep an audience. And you're also competing with a lot of other artists that are, you know. But I would start, and everything stopped in Beaubourg. I'd get these huge crowds, and because I was just doing things that you aren't allowed to do. You know, they just thought, this guy's crazy, this clown is crazy, he'll do anything. Sometimes at nighttime, I'd work at the very famous Saint-Germain-des-Prés. There was a very famous cafe called Les Deux Magots, and it's beautiful. And across the street was a really very old church, really beautiful area, perfect place to do shows in the night. And sometimes I'd literally go in the middle of the street. I had like the Snoopy dog, or was it Ragdoll? I don't know what it was. And I'd stop the traffic, and I'd take this doll across the street, and it had a heart attack, and I had to give the doll CPR, and they'd be honking their horns, and,
they
were screaming at me. I can't help it, they don't want me to do it. I was crazy. I remember in Boulder, I would literally stop cars and take, if it was a woman, I'd take the woman out of that car and put her in another car with a guy who didn't have a woman. I changed them. One day the police came up to me and said, "Hey, David, you don't need to be stopping traffic every night. You gotta stop that. You gotta come up with some other stuff." I said, "Okay, I won't do that." But anyways, going back to Paris, yeah, Bernard Paul saw potential in me, and wasn't really involved in forming me in any way. I just learned very quickly how to control it and bring it down. And
just one side quest. How was your command of French?
I didn't know any French, but I loved the language, so I learned it quite quickly.
Just on the streets?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the street French. Beautiful thing about working in the streets in front of Beauvoir, there were a lot of Algerians that were out of work, a lot of Arabs out of work, a lot of drug addicts, and they were there all the time, every day. They didn't have any work, and they just screamed, They saw this guy who was, for them, I was, an anarchist, a total anarchist, basically doing this to everything. There are no boundaries. But I did it with a sense of love and caring. I never did anything that was rude or insulting in any way. It was always like, well, let's play and have fun. And in the summer, in July, I would go to the south of France. They have a festival every year in July, Festival of Avignon, Festival of Theater. And I'd go there and work in front of the Palais de Pape, huge old palace in the center of Avignon. And there's a big square in front of that palace. And I'd work there in the evenings. And it was glorious. It was absolutely glorious because there was enough light for everybody to see me. And I just improvised, and that's where I started to develop the cinema number. I actually started to develop a cinema number in Paris, but I took it a step further in Avignon. And I would get these huge crowds, and in the palace, they would have Anya Mushkin, the director of the Théâtre du Soleil. They'd be doing Shakespeare, these huge productions, and literally, she'd have to come out sometimes and go, "Got to quiet down. We're trying to do a show." Because people would be screaming. And it was really beautiful because after the shows, people would literally come up to me and just stare at me like I was from another world. Just stare at me. Because they would think, what is this guy doing? He's just involving everyone. I developed a way of getting very close to people in an instant, really close to them, standing next to them and mimicking them in a way that would, without them even moving, would show a bit of who they were. I could just feel it. And very subtle movements I would do and facial gestures, and they'd get really uncomfortable. And people would scream because they'd see me being them in a second. So I learned to figure things out really quick in terms of audience participation.
At this point, about how old are you?
30, I guess.
30, okay.
29, 30.
Okay. And you've been in Paris at that point for?
3 years.
Okay.
Yeah. It was a really romantic, exciting time because there were a lot of street artists and a lot of us became friends. And at the end of the day, we'd all go to the same bar and drink Beaujolais and I remember there was an artist, René Vazinet, who was really good. He was working with another guy, and they just did sketches. And René was really famous for his parties. And he lived on a street between the Latin Quarter and the Saint-Germain-des-Prés. There's a very famous street, Rue Saint-André-des-Arts. And René had like a second-story apartment up there. And on weekends, you just walk down, you get close to Renee's apartment, just hashish. you could just smell hash just pouring out of the windows. And you'd go into his, you know, I'd knock on his door, and they would answer it in some kind of buffon costume or some kind of clown. And his little apartment would be full of writers, poets, street artists, clowns. I wasn't into the drugs or anything, but they'd all, it was really, really interesting. But there was a camaraderie. We were street artists. We were, you know, these crazy people that worked the streets, and it was glorious. It was really a wonderful time. Because you're an artist and you're free. If you need any money, you just go down the streets, pass your hat. I never went up to people with my hat, because when I saw artists doing that, it always looked like they were begging. I just put it on the ground and let them come in and do what they wanted. So, and I made enough money, I would learn like 500 or 600 friends a day. You know, in those days it was okay. So I had enough for an apartment, I had enough to live, and it was all black money.
So what's the next thing that happened that changed the trajectory?
Okay, so this is the thing that changed my life. So one day, a woman from the New York Times came, and she was interviewing street artists for an article for the Times. And she was talking to me, and she was interviewing me, and she said, she asked me, do you know Bill Irwin? And I said, no. She said, oh, I have a video. You want to, you know, he's this big star in America, in New York. And he's this clown. And I looked at the video, and it was his show, The Regarded Flight. And I just was, I mean, I thought, this is the best clown in the world. Oh, what is he? He's like, really, man, he's glorious. I mean, he's a dancer, he's an actor, he's got great routines, he's brilliant, he's a poet. And I say poet in terms of Bill, it was able to, in his style of movement, it was poetry to watch him. He had a routine where he would just like run in a circle and trip. And he was really happy to be running in a circle and he'd trip, and he'd be happy again and run in a circle, trip in the same spot. And then he'd come around to that spot and jump over it, thinking he had, you know, he wasn't gonna trip again, and he'd fall in his face. But the way he did it was poetic, because, you know, it really, like, this is the height of the great clowning for me. He was communicating to the collective unconscious of suffering, you know, the struggle we all go through in life. And that, you know, you do your best and, you know, sometimes you land on your face. But the way he did it was just brilliant. Anyways, so, I left the streets. I did Roncalli, and I really didn't like it because it was 12 shows a week, and that was insane. We had no days off. You only had on Monday and Tuesday one show. All the other days you had two shows, and I just couldn't do it. So the director, I could tell you a story, but that's for another time. It was like out of a movie. He wanted me to. He wanted to keep me there because, you know, I was a star, and I signed a contract for more money. And then I realized I couldn't do it because it was too much. I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. It was I wouldn't be able to survive it. And so I called him, and he totally flipped out. He went bananas, and he came over to I that's where I met my wife, and we were together then. And he came over to the apartment in his fur coat, and, you know, with his chauffeur and everything. And he came up to the I won't tell the rest of it, I don't want to talk bad about somebody. But it was bizarre. It was really bizarre. You know, he threatened me in horrible ways. But nothing came of it. Then I was approached by Cirque du Soleil. They were just getting a start. And I did Circus Knie one season after that. I did Circus Knie, which was a lot of fun. And then I got approached by Cirque du Soleil, and so I joined Cirque. That was just after their first show. It was Nouvelle Experience, and so I moved to Montreal, and I was directly involved in the creation of Nouvelle Experience. I was the clown there, but I also wrote the story and co-directed it. Because in those days, we were just having fun. Franco Dragone was there, but I had all these ideas, and they let me go. Gilles Lebouté was just, well, David, do whatever you want. So that show just catapulted me into the stratosphere. And when we went to New York with the show, someone came backstage before the show and they said, "Bill Irwin's in the audience. Bill Irwin's in the audience." I was never so terrified in my life. And so I said, "Oh my God, yeah, okay, look, during the intermission, please get one of the ushers to bring him backstage. I want to meet him." So Bill came backstage and I met him, and it was after the show. I met him and I said, "Oh, I love your work." And he said, "Oh yeah, I love what you do." And I said, "Well, let's have coffee together tomorrow." He said, "Yeah, sure." So we ended up actually having lunch. And then he invited me over to his office after that. And he had this office right in the Village. And it was full of hats. He had a lot of hats. And I took one big hat and put it on. It was like this high. And it was a lovely day. And the next morning, I got a knock on my hotel room door, and the guy gave me a big box. He said, "This is for you." And I opened it, and it was the hat that I put on in Bill Irwin's office. He said, "Oh, you look so good in this, I thought, you know, I'd give it to you." So that really, like, was a friendship. Anyways, then we ended up getting cast together in a movie. I didn't know it, you know. We talked about working together, but nothing happened. But we just suddenly were in this movie together, Sam Shepard's Silent Tongue, and we played two medicine show clowns. And so we had no material. We had to come up with some material. And we started rehearsing stuff, you know, improvising. And it was like butter. I couldn't believe it. I'd do something, Bill would do something. And it was like we'd been working together for years. And we were practicing, and then suddenly it became completely silent on the movie set. And I turned around, everybody had been watching us. It was so mesmerizing, this magic we had. Then I had an agent, and he called me and said, "They want you to do the Sirius Fun Festival at Lincoln Center." And I said, "Well, I don't have a whole show, I can't do that. I don't have a whole show, I have a couple numbers." So I said, "Hey, Bill, you know, how would you like to do this Sirius Fun Festival?" And Bill, and that was New York, that was his hometown, that was his beat. He said, "Well, Dave, I don't, Bill's like that. He's very serious." And
it's very good.
"Yes, well, Dave." And it takes Bill forever to make decisions. "Well, I think about it." And there was a band that was also in the movie, the Red Clay Runway.
Certainly, yeah.
And I was just, you know, I was just like, "Hey, let's jam. Let's have some fun, you know." Bill, so it took Bill a week, and he said, "Yeah, okay, we'll do it." And then I said, "Hey, you know, the band can do the music." He said, "Yeah, cool." And it was just like, how naive, but it worked. So next thing I knew, you know, Bill and I started rehearsing some stuff, and the Red Clay Ramblers played. We did two nights there, and it just went to the roof. And then we got, you know, approached by a producer, and I think within the period of 4 months, we were on Broadway.
Just like that.
And it was, the thing was, when I saw Bill in the video in Paris, I suddenly had this dream to work with this guy. That if I want to work with anybody, it's him, but I never thought of it. You know, because Bill for me was the god of clowning. And I just couldn't believe that this had happened to me. I couldn't believe that I was working with the best clown in the world. Not only that, we had a Tony Award, and we had this huge poster in Times Square. I couldn't believe it. You know, as a street clown, from the streets to Broadway. And that was quite an experience.
So you just did what you did. People found you. Occasionally they recognized what you did was something they wanted. And so when you said you wrote the script, of, you came in and started writing.
Oh, for Cirque du Soleil?
Yeah, writing. You just, okay, I'll write a script.
Yeah, I didn't know I had this talent, you know? If I had been smart, I could retire years ago. But I was just having fun. Let's jam, let's make a great show. And Guy, you know, we got very close because Guy loved what he was there almost every show laughing his ass off. The cinema number became, this is a wild thing. I mean, it was insane. I would look into the audience and, you know, there are 2,500 seats in Surrey. Literally see these waves of people bending over. And at these nights where I would just go crazy, really crazy. When you get on that level of improvisation, when you're really connecting with the audience and the people you've chosen. And I was always very careful to choose the right people. You really have to be careful. And I learned how to work with them. And I started to learn how to see who was coming on stage. I could tell a lot about a guy when I shook his hand and looked in his eyes. I had a sense of how he was going to be or how she was going to be. But I learned that very quickly. What was the question again? It was just having fun.
So then you're on, you're on Broadway. It's a Tony Award winning show. And you were fabulous because you were crazy.
Yeah, and you know, the beautiful thing about working with Bill was Bill was really humble. You know, there could have been, you know, a really kind of competitive thing, but there never was. It was a mutual love and respect for each other's work, and as human beings. And Bill, every night at the cinema, Bill watched it every single night. He'd be sitting off stage, and it really gave me a great feeling. And I'd say, Bill, what the hell are you doing there? He said, David, it's different every night. I laugh my ass off. I said, look, okay, but now you've got to come out and you've got to start coming out. And so he'd start coming out, and Bill was great at choosing the right moments to come out and interact with the audience. You know, like sometimes I would, like I'd have the clapboard guy, and if he was, sometimes I could be really, really rude. And the meaner and ruder I was, the more they'd laugh. But I always did it with a sense of respect and love. That was the most important thing. To really do it in a way, to do it knowing that you really, truly care about people. You truly, really care about them. And then they'll let you do whatever the hell you want with them. But Bill, like I would be getting upset with the clapboard guy. And, you know, one night I came up with this idea of just go back. Keep going back. You know, just keep going back until he was off stage. Then I'd do this thing like, okay, now walk down the stairs, open the door, call a taxi, and get the hell out of here. And Bill was laughing his ass off. I said, Bill, look, you've got to come out and help me fire these guys. And Bill would come out, and the way he did, he said, like, the only Bill ever could do, really apologetically, you know, I'm so sorry, this guy's out of his mind. You gotta leave the stage. You're really not very good. It was hysterical, really hysterical. Bill's brilliance is the subtlety, you know, his subtlety. And always being very apologetic. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. So he just would come in every now and then and just, you know, bring the house down.
And it's sweet and sour, working together very well.
Oh, you know, the angel and the devil. You know, that's what life is.
Were the Red Clay Ramblers, were they performing as improvisationally as you? Or were they playing set pieces?
No, they were playing set pieces.
Okay.
That was all rehearsed, really well rehearsed.
Okay.
Playing set pieces. Yeah. And, you know, when you get that, you become that successful, it's really, the beauty of clowning is that, you know, you're taking human suffering and transforming it into laughter. And so you develop this real empathy and love and compassion for your fellow humanity, and that, you know, everything that you do is a gift. It's not, you know, you're not really doing it. It's a gift, and so you can't really say, you know, I did this. You know, this. You know, I did this. No, it's something that's given, and so there's only gratitude for that. You know, just gratitude.
I can't believe what you said earlier. Who would want to hear any of this? This has been freaking fascinating and a wonderful way of saying, okay, this is how I grew up, this is the way, and it has formed every step along the way of how I do it. And you observed not only carefully, but almost scientifically observed people and the other workers and everything that's going on, and then taking that and creating every step along the way.
Yeah, it's, you know, I say that, you know, really great clowning is really, it's about understanding that the clown lives in between two worlds, a world of great joy and a world of great sorrow. And the clown is walking a high wire, balancing those two together. And the clown has, you know, what the clown does is, as a magician, he brings those two worlds together, and which creates a deep a vulnerability and a compassion and tenderness for others, because you know what human suffering is. And I think I could only do, like one night in a show, we had this beautiful opening of Full Moon. I would come in looking for my seat, and Bill would come out with the microphone. It was beautiful. It was just a brilliant 10 minutes of work. And, you know, Usher was always sending me to other, you know, always up to the balcony. Now your seat's not here. I was getting more and more pissed off. That guy, I'd walk through the row first and looking for my seat. Hey, you're in my seat, get out. That's when I start getting pissed off. Get out of my seat. And then Usher would come down and look at my ticket and go, no, no, you're up in the box. And get really pissed off. No, this is, so I'd go up in the, I'd go leave and go up to the box, and Bill would come out and do the microphone. I'd walk into the box and someone else was in my seat. And I'm getting really pissed off. Get out of my seat. Right. And if it was a woman, sometimes in the winter they have a mink coat, you know. And get out of my seat. No, come on, come on. And I help them get out of the seat, you know. I take their mink coat and hand it to them as they went out. And, you know, get in my seat and get all set. And I had this whole thing where I was adjusting everything, waiting to look. And the usher would come in with the woman again, right, with her mink coat over her arm. And I get really nice and say, okay, I'm so sorry. Put her in her seat, take me a coat and chuck it. You know, it's made the 30,000 shoo was over there. And then of course, she'd say, no, you're on the over there in that box. Now I'm really getting pissed off. And I'd leave and Bill would come out and do his stuff, brilliant stuff at the mic. And I'd come out with a big thing of popcorn and go to the guy who was the first guy in my place and just dump the whole thing on his head. And disappear. Anyways, I'd end up in the other box. And one night there was an old lady in my seat. Get out of my seat. Now, give me a program, chuck a program. You know, take your ticket, rip it up, throw it, get out of the seat. And I looked at her and I knew I can do anything with this woman. I can do anything with this woman. Get out of my seat. And I grabbed her, pushed her against the wall. She was about 80, and started sucker punching her like this. And she's doing this. And people were screaming. How could you, you know, what that, you know? I couldn't do that today. They would arrest me, you know? It's sad. It's really sad that it's becoming the way it is now, because even if I did the cinema number, I wouldn't be able to touch a woman, and I never, ever, ever would ever dream of doing anything inappropriate. That was never what it was. It was sweet and innocent. But nowadays, it's, you know, it's hard. But you don't need to go there. So
it's been fascinating, and I think it got to where I was hoping to get, just find out how you got to what you were doing and what were the steps along the way that were critical and how you handled and learned and just kept going.
The last thing that I did, 2007, I met with Guy Laliberté, and I said, look, Guy, I want to do my own show. I said, okay, okay, what do you want to do? I said, I don't know. He said, okay, do whatever you want. And these shows are like $30 million. And he said, do whatever you want. And I was like, ooh, shit. He said, yes. But that's where I really took all the experience, everything I learned, and put it into that show. And it's now their longest running touring show. It is now, it's been remounted again. I just played 2.5 months in Montreal, sold out every show, you know, like 4 standing ovations. It's, and I've looked at that show and I thought, the beauty of that show is that it's all about the artist. Everything is centered on the artist. Because circuit become really high tech, and move further away from focusing on the beauty of each individual artist. So everything I did was to make them look as good as they possibly could. And I had this amazing team of people that gave me exactly what I wanted. And you know, I can still watch the show, and the music is just phenomenal. I mean, the whole show is, I look at it and think, yeah, that's exactly what I wanted to do. And I couldn't, you know, most of the time you create something, you go, well, it was almost, you know, but that was, yeah, he gave me this incredible team of people. If you get a chance to see it, you gotta see it. It's really, really beautiful. And it has a sweet story. And every choice I made in directing that was, I asked myself, is this choice bringing the audience closer to the artist? Is this choice bringing the audience closer to each other? Is this choice about our shared humanity, where it's all inclusive, that there is no separation between the artist and the audience, that the audience feels, that the audience, what the artists are giving the audience is the hope that and the joy of seeing that the impossible is possible. These artists are doing the impossible. They are doing the impossible. And I created 2 new clown numbers for the show when it reopened after Corona. Mm-hmm. And the clowns are very, very funny.
Is it touring or is it in set?
It's touring. No, it's touring. It left Montreal. Sunday was the last show, and I'm moving to another town in Canada. But they're going to do another tour through America, another world tour. It's just unstoppable. Only because it's timeless in the sense that it's about the artist. It's about the pure artistry in terms of the clowning and all the artists. And I also, you know, I have Dark and Light now, which I like. Mm-hmm. You know, the second act opens with death.
Death.
With a coat of rats. And demons and skeletons. And it's really cool. So,
this has been fabulous.
What I love about clowns, every clown I've ever met has a heart of gold. Every single clown I've ever met truly cares about others. And that's why we do it. Right? So that's why I love working and teaching and being around clowns. It's beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.